Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Secrets to Happiness by Sarah Dunn, narrated by Julie Dretzin. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Sarah Dunn. This recording is copyrighted 2009 by Recorded Books. Holly Frick has just endured the worst kind of breakup, the kind where you're still in love with your ex. While her wounds are still dangerously close to the surface, Holly decides to forge an entirely new path to Nirvana. And now, Secrets to Happiness.
Secrets to Happiness by Sarah Dunn. A Happy Marriage. Do you want to know the secret to a happy marriage? Tell me. Put your wife on Paxil. People told Holly all sorts of things. She didn't know why, really. Maybe it had something to do with her face, which was wide open and promised kindness. Holly's face was much kinder than she actually was. She had big green eyes and extremely pale skin and an easy, forgiving smile. But the real problem was probably her dimples. Holly was one of the 7 grown women left in Manhattan who still had them, dimples, which meant that strangers were always asking her for change for a 20 or to watch their laptops in Starbucks. Once, a woman she'd never met before asked her to hold her baby while she strapped a car seat into the back of a taxi. Part of the reason Holly had trouble with men was they mistook her face for the truth. They felt she had vast, untapped reservoirs of understanding and ended up telling her all of the sordid and shameful bits of their histories. And when they saw not so much as a flicker of judgment pass over her features, they kept right on going. It was, Holly found, a great thing for a writer to have people tell you things, but it could wreak havoc on relationships. "Amanda's taking Paxil?" said Holly. Mark nodded yes and lowered his voice to just above a whisper. "She's a completely different person. It's like I woke up one morning and suddenly found myself married to this sweet and lovely woman. She's always been a bit of a, well, I don't want to say bitch, but..." He looked up in the air for a second, searching for the word. "Let's just go with difficult. I mean that in the best possible way. She's really intelligent and impressive and opinionated, and I love her. I really do. But it was getting pretty tough to live with her." "Yeah, but isn't that kind of alarming? I mean, that a pill could make that much of a difference?" "Alarming? Are you kidding? It's the best thing that ever happened to me." Amanda came in from the kitchen carrying a small bowl of black olives. Amanda was one of those women who start out thin and spend their 30s getting progressively thinner. Holly couldn't figure out how she did it. It was almost like she discovered a magic pill or was involved with some sort of spooky voodoo that she insisted on keeping to herself. Amanda kept getting thinner, and her hair kept getting shorter and spikier, and her eyes, defying all known laws of human biology, kept getting bigger. Amanda was beautiful, Holly had to admit. But she was in danger of turning into a bony, bug-eyed elf. "I didn't know you started taking Paxil," said Holly.
"I love it," said Amanda. "You should try it."
"Why? I'm not depressed." Amanda and Mark just looked at her. "Why is everyone convinced there's something wrong with me?" said Holly. "Last night I was on the phone with my stepmother, and I told her I was thinking about getting a dog, and she said, 'Oh, good, that means you're ready to receive love again.'"
"She said that?" said Amanda.
"She did. And I said to her,
'Oh, Ellen, don't you worry about me. I've been receiving love,'" said Holly. She popped an olive into her mouth. "I've been receiving love in, you know, multiple orifices."
"You did not," said Amanda.
"I wanted to."
"What's she even talking about?" said Amanda. "You've been ready to receive love." Mark was sitting on the edge of the couch with a bottle of Pinot Noir Holly had brought and one of those rabbit ear wine openers.
"What kind of dog?" he asked.
"I haven't got that far," said Holly. "I'll probably just go to a shelter."
"When we rescued Peppo," said Amanda, "I did all sorts of research about dogs that are happy in apartments and breeds that do well in New York, but when it came down to it, I wanted the kind of dog I grew up with."
Holly gave Amanda a look.
"What?" said Amanda.
"He's a pedigreed Portuguese water dog. You had to fly to Oregon to pick him up from the breeder. How is that a rescue?"
"That's how it works with purebreds. People who adopt them have to sign a contract that they'll return them to the breeder if they don't want the dog anymore. Then the breeder finds a rescue home for it."
"Yeah, but that's not really a rescue. I mean, you didn't rescue him from anything. That's just a used dog."
"Peppo's a rescue, Holly."
Holly looked over at Mark to get some backup. He'd spent $1,000 plus airfare on the dog, Holly knew for a fact, because he'd complained quite loudly about it at the time. But he was hunched over the coffee table, fussing with the wine opener, oblivious. She knew from experience that pursuing this line of reasoning with Amanda was futile, so she decided to change the subject. "What exactly is your husband wearing on his feet?"
"Oh, you noticed Mark's slipper socks. Attractive, aren't they?"
Mark's slipper socks were just that. Oatmeal-colored wool socks with a brown leather outsole stitched onto the bottom, like feety pajamas without the pajamas.
"I mean, I know I'm like family," said Holly, "but I don't think you should inflict those things on family."
"The astronauts wear these," said Mark. "These are astronauts' slippers. Standard issue since 1982.
"Have you become an astronaut?" said Amanda.
"Did I miss something? Have you given up investment banking in order to explore outer space?"
"Hey, I love these slippers," said Mark. "I want to be buried in these slippers."
Amanda looked at Holly and gave a little marital, "What can you do?" shrug of her shoulders.
"Oh, I almost forgot," said Holly. "I have to show you something. Can I borrow your laptop?"
"Of course." Holly sat down on the couch with Amanda's computer and managed to open up her email.
"Listen to this," she said.
"Dear Holly, this is going to sound strange, but I'm writing regarding Spence Samuelson. I have been dating him for about 8 months, talking about a serious future together, and now something catastrophic has happened. I don't know how you might feel about talking with me about this, but I would love to hear your perspective. Thank you, Kathleen Wheeler." And then she leaves her phone number with a Colorado area code.
"Oh, my God," said Amanda.
"Who is Spence Samuelson?" asked Mark.
"He was the ex before the ex," Amanda explained.
"The guy before the ex-husband. He was before your time."
"Wait," Mark turned to Holly. "He's the shitty guy in your book?"
"Exactly," said Amanda. Holly said a tad formally, "The character of Palmer was fictional, but sort of loosely in the broadest possible way, based on Spence."
Amanda rolled her eyes at this. She knew the truth, which was that Holly had changed exactly 2 details about Spence when turning him into Palmer, his name and the color of his eyes.
"Did you call her?" said Mark.
"Not yet."
"Are you crazy? Do it now," said Amanda. "Put her on speakerphone."
"The woman said something catastrophic happened," said Mark. "I don't think we should put her on our speakerphone."
"You know, after I got this email, I had an epiphany," said Holly. "This is why I wrote a novel, for this exact experience, to have girlfriends of men I used to date track me down and ask me for advice. It'll be like being a therapist without having to get a degree."
"Lord," said Mark.
"What?" said Holly.
"That poor, sad schmuck," said Mark. "He has no idea what he's in for."
Holly Frick had had the worst kind of divorce, The kind where you're still in love with the person who is divorcing you. Not fond of, not still attached to, not building a life together, hopelessly in love with. And it was a year ago exactly that Alex had left her, a fact that had somehow slipped her notice up until earlier that evening, when she went to hail a cab and saw the dried-out Christmas trees heaped in sad piles along the sidewalk. Alex had left her on January 3rd. Kind of like a benevolent CEO who holds off on the pink slips until after the holidays. Alex had left Holly abruptly, more or less out of the blue, not for another woman, not even for another man, but for, it would seem, women, as many as he could get his hands on. The rumors came back to her throughout the spring and summer, trickling in from various gossipy sources. Stories about his fling with the frosty Thai hostess at Dow, a graduate student who worked in the basement of Shakespeare and Company. The model who sold lingerie at Barney's. Holly's therapist claimed she'd metabolized the breakup of her marriage like a trauma victim. That it happened so suddenly and so unexpectedly, it was like she'd been in a car accident. Or the subject of a violent crime, which Holly figured was as good an explanation as any as to why she'd spent the past year of her life feeling like she was underwater. She knew that what she was going through was nothing special, just garden variety heartbreak, the sort of thing that poets and novelists had been writing about for hundreds of years. But she also knew, from those same books, that there were people who never recover from it, ones who go on through life beset by a dim and painful longing. It wasn't until that day, when she saw the Christmas trees littering the street and was shocked to realize a full year had gone by, that she started to fear she might be one of them. Amanda and Mark had a baby, a 13-month-old named Jacob, who was asleep in his room for most of the evening, but made a brief cameo appearance around the time of the last Mushu pancake. Jacob was huge. At his 6-month birthday party, he was the size of a small 2-year-old. But seeing as he had only about a 30% chance of transferring his pacifier from his fist to his mouth on any given try, he seemed vaguely retarded. He wasn't, though. He was just too big. Holly and Amanda had years earlier come up with a name for just this sort of baby, Blonde Blob, because, and you'll see that this is true, these enormous blobby babies are invariably blonde. But that was before Amanda had gone and given birth to one. After Jacob went back down, Holly and Amanda settled in on the couch with a fresh bottle of wine while Mark dozed in his chair. "Talk," said Amanda.
"What? I'm good."
"Good? Not that good," said Holly, "but better." "That's still good."
"It's weird," said Holly. "A couple of weeks ago, I woke up on a Saturday morning, and I hadn't made plans with anybody. So the whole day was sitting there, stretched out in front of me, this big blank, which usually makes me feel all panicky and anxious and bad about myself."
"You should have called," Amanda interrupted. "You could have come over."
"Yeah, I know. Thanks. Anyhow, I got dressed and I made my way downtown and I did some Christmas shopping and then at around 4, I went to see a movie I'd been wanting to see at the Film Forum. And then I came home and made a nice dinner for myself with real cooking involved and I ate off the good plates and, you know, in the end, I had this really great day. And the whole time I was aware of the fact that I was by myself, but I wasn't bothered by it the way I would have been in the past," said Holly.
She reached for the bottle of wine and refilled both of their glasses.
"I got married. I tried that. It didn't work out for me. And maybe I'm just one of those people who are meant to be alone."
"You're going to meet someone, Holly?"
"I don't know if I even want to. Honestly, I'm fine alone. I feel like this is the first time in my life I've been able to say that and have it be completely true," said Holly.
I'm fine alone.
Of course you're fine.
And it feels good, you know, to finally be in a good place with all of this.
And you're not really alone.
I'm pretty alone. Holly took a big swallow of wine and closed her eyes.
I miss Alex.
No, you don't, said Amanda.
I do. I miss him, said Holly. Her voice got small. I think I'm still in love with him.
You're not in love with Alex.
Okay, so what is it then when you walk by a restaurant you used to go to together, you get tears in your eyes and your chest feels like there's a huge hole in it and you have to go straight home and crawl into bed and get under the covers? What can that possibly mean other than I still love him?
That's grief. That's healthy.
I don't know, said Holly. It feels like love.
It doesn't matter, said Amanda. You guys weren't happy together.
I think maybe we were.
You were miserable, Holly.
So? I'm miserable now, and I'm not sure it's all that much better to be miserable alone than to be miserable with another person, said Holly.
She thrust her forefinger in the air as the thought came to her.
Misery loves company.
You're drunk.
I do like to drink.
You can sleep over if you want.
No, that'll just make me feel more pathetic, said Holly.
She flopped back against the cushions and stared up at the ceiling, which was flickering in the candlelight.
God, I fucked up my life. My novel was a spectacular failure. I'm back writing for TV, for the world's crappiest TV show, if anyone's keeping score. I'm 35 years old, utterly alone, and the outer walls of my eggs are taking on the consistency of tissue paper as we speak. Meanwhile, Alex leaves me and his life is going great. I think he's dating someone pretty seriously.
What makes you say that?
Nothing, really, said Holly. I'm just pretty sure he is.
Amanda put down her wine glass and looked hard at Holly. Are you still checking his email?
No.
Holly?
I'm not. I promise, said Holly. He changed his code.
Mark opened one eye and piped in from his recliner. You were checking your ex-husband's email?
I'm not proud of it.
Amanda got off the couch and headed towards the kitchen with a few dirty glasses. Don't take this the wrong way, but I think you should really seriously consider getting a new therapist.
Hey, you can't blame this on her, Holly called after her. I don't tell her things like this. Trust me, she'd be appalled.
A few minutes later, Holly rolled off the couch and joined Amanda in the kitchen. After briefly rallying, just long enough to suggest that Holly, A, consider internet dating, because a 43-year-old at his office met a guy from Teaneck that way and she was pretty fat, or B, maybe take a salsa dancing class, Mark had fallen back into a slipper-socked slumber. Amanda was at the sink with the rubber gloves on. Holly picked up a sponge and went to work on the countertops. Your husband thinks all my problems would be solved if I signed up for a salsa dancing class.
That's not the worst idea, said Amanda. You like to dance.
My friend Betsy took a salsa dancing class, and when she went out to the hallway during the break, one of the guys from the class was just standing there, leaning against the wall, perfectly normal, with his hand down his pants.
Was he, like, doing things to himself?
Does it matter? Said Holly. Really, with that story, does it matter why his hand was in his pants?
I see your point, Amanda said, and then she turned off the faucet.
I have to talk to you about something.
What?
Well, it's kind of complicated.
Did I do something wrong? Said Holly.
No, no, of course not. It's not about you.
Well, then what is it?
It's... Now, this is going to seem like a bigger thing than I meant it to be, and it's really nothing. Okay. About a month ago, I met a guy at this benefit thing I went to. Uh-huh. His name is Jack, and he knows my old boss, Teresa. We talked about Teresa a lot at first. The woman is out of her mind. And we just got into this dynamic with each other. Then we had lunch and, you know, a few emails back and forth. Nothing big. I'm missing the part that's complicated. Yeah, well, that's just it, said Amanda. It's getting complicated. Spell it out for me, said Holly. Are you sleeping with him? God, no. No, nothing like that. Good. Then what is it? I don't know what it is. I'm a little confused, said Amanda. Feelings are getting involved. Does Mark know about it? No, said Amanda. I mean, he knows there's a guy out there named Jack. I've mentioned his name a few times, but he doesn't know. Holly put the sponge down. So what you're telling me is you're dating somebody. Of course not, said Amanda. We've had a couple of innocent lunches. You shouldn't talk to me about this, said Holly. I'm no good with infidelity. I always over-identify with the cuckolded party. This isn't infidelity, Holly. Then why are we whispering in the kitchen? Amanda opened the cabinet and took out three coffee mugs. What are you telling me this for? I want you to meet him. What? Said Holly. Why? I don't know, said Amanda. You'll like him. You'll like each other. I don't think I want to meet him, said Holly. I'll feel complicit. I feel guilty even having this conversation. Why should you feel guilty? I don't know, said Holly. Somebody should feel guilty, and I tend to feel all the feelings in the room. Just meet us for lunch next week, will you please? We'll see. Is that a yes? It's a we'll see. The X before the X. Some 40 blocks uptown, on the 37th floor of the Jockistan, a monstrous glass-walled midtown apartment complex that blocked the sun from a healthy stretch of 46th Street for several months of the year. Spence Samuelson, the ex before the ex, the guy before the ex-husband, a.k.a. the shitty guy in Holly's book, was spending his evening alone, drinking vodka and messing around on his computer. He'd read a while back that scientists in New Jersey were building a particle accelerator the size of a sports stadium in order to create a black hole. A black hole which would then, presumably, swallow the scientists and the stadium and the state of New Jersey and the rest of the known universe, and he thought they could save themselves a lot of trouble simply by combining a high-speed internet connection with carefully titrated amounts of 80-proof grain alcohol. When he heard the phone ring, he looked up from his screen and saw it was nearly 10 o'clock. He'd forgotten to have dinner.
I can't believe you,
said an angry yet sniffly voice. It was his girlfriend, Kathleen, calling from Boulder, and it didn't sound good.
What? What did I do?
What did you do?
I don't know, Spence. Why don't you tell me what you did?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, God. I'm seriously going to lose it if you keep lying to me.
What do you want me to say?
Why don't you go open up your email?
Spence clicked on his email. He could hear Kathleen through the phone line, angry breathing, fuming. That was what she was doing. He opened up a file of digital photos she had forwarded to him.
Oh, shit. Shit, shit, shit. Oh, my God, Kathleen, I'm so sorry.
I don't want to hear that,
she said.
I want to know the truth.
Did I sleep with her?
Spence said. He looked at the picture on his computer screen.
Did he dare?
No, there was no getting around it.
Yes. Did I lie to you about it? Yes. Am I hugely sorry I did both of those things? More than you can imagine.
You need help, Spence.
I probably do.
No, I'm being serious here, said Kathleen. You need professional help.
I'll go see someone if that will make you feel better.
Do you know what's going through my head right now? I'm sitting here wondering, actually, seriously contemplating, Spence, whether or not you are a sociopath. Because I can't think of any other explanation for this. I don't see how you maintain this level of deceit. You had a chance to tell me the truth 2 days ago, and you didn't. Only when confronted with photographic evidence are you willing to admit that you slept with this person.
Jesus, Kathleen, I'm not a sociopath, he said. I fucked up. I wish I hadn't, but I did. I'm sorry.
You fucked up, she said flatly.
I love you. You know I love you. She doesn't mean anything to me. You can tell she's out of her mind. Who would take a picture like that? She is not a normal person.
Silence on the line.
I love you, Kathleen.
More silence.
I have to get off the phone now, said Kathleen.
Can we talk later? Said Spence.
I don't know.
And she hung up. Spence put the phone back in its cradle and sat down on the couch. Just what exactly was he guilty of? He had dated two women at the same time. More precisely, he had long-distance dated one woman who he genuinely cared about, Kathleen, and occasionally, albeit repeatedly, slept with another woman who happened to live closer by, Crazy Molly. He never dated Crazy Molly, that wasn't the word for it. He would bump into Molly at a party, the possibility of sex would rear its tantalizing head, and Spence would think some drunken blend of the following two thoughts. This will be the last time. I'd be an idiot to pass this up. That was his crime. And now he'd been caught. That all this would happen now, Spence found truly unfair, because the last time he slept with Molly was going to be the last time. He was finished with all that. The span of time between orgasm and guilt and self-loathing had grown infinitesimally small. Finally, he felt like he was getting some clarity. Finally, he was seeing the path forward. He was picturing a life with Kathleen, sweet Kathleen, settling down, growing up, putting his life into some sort of order. Just last week, he had given considerable thought to moving out to Boulder to be with her. He could start mountain biking again. Their kids could grow up on skis. Instead, what had happened was this. 2 days earlier, on the night of what was to be the last time, Molly had, in a round of dead-of-night post-coital snooping, stumbled upon a card sent to him by Kathleen. Kathleen was the kind of girl who, at 36, sent men cards, which could explain why she was taking all this so hard. The next day, Crazy Molly tracked Kathleen down and called her up and said something along the lines of, "Stay away from my boyfriend." And Kathleen went berserk. She called Spence, sobbing, hysterical, hurling accusations left and right. And here he made what might have been a pivotal mistake. He went with a blanket denial. He said flat out that none of it had happened. He'd never slept with her. Crazy Molly was crazy. It was right there in her name. He loved Kathleen. She was the kind of girl he wanted to marry. Hadn't they talked about having three kids together? If he had had time to develop a strategy, he might have just as easily gone with the truth, because, really, he didn't think the truth was so bad. The truth, Spence believed he was falling in love with Kathleen, but while he was figuring it out, he had engaged in some typically shitty male behavior, although he did so entirely devoid of malice and without believing that it could have any negative impact on their growing relationship. And Kathleen, 36 and single and living in Boulder, carrier of felted hand-knit purses and wearer of clunky Mountain Time Zone shoes, whose obsessive love for her two dogs telegraphed a desperate desire for a family, probably would have given him a second chance. Of course, hindsight is 20/20. He went with the denial, and Kathleen more or less bought it. She lobbed a few doozies at him along the lines of, "I need some sort of concrete evidence that you are committed to this relationship," which Spence handled with the care of someone charged with disposing of nuclear waste. He bought her a ticket to come to New York for 5 days so they could discuss his level of commitment. Things appeared to go back to normal. But then, earlier that day, Crazy Molly had emailed Kathleen a few photographs to bolster her case that she was, in fact, Spence's girlfriend, including, most notably, a picture of herself lying naked in bed next to him while he was fast asleep. Her arm was outstretched, holding the camera up in the air in the manner of a drunken reveler. His eyes were closed, and she was grinning like a maniac. Who takes pictures like that? Crazy people, thought Spence. Still, tough to explain away. Crazy Molly was known as Crazy Molly, not because she took a lot of psychoactive medication, or even because she'd been institutionalized in college, but because she was a crazy sex girl. She was sort of famous for it. That was the only reason Spence went to bed with her in the first place. Sometimes a man needs some crazy sex, and he knew he could never explain this to Kathleen. Kathleen, who was by no means a prude, who liked dirty talk in bed as much as the next girl, maybe more, but who did not understand that what they were having was not, in fact, crazy sex. The truth was this. Kathleen thought she was a crazy sex girl. She thought she and Spence were having wild and crazy sex, and she was immensely proud of herself for it. In the idea that she was falling short by an order of magnitude would what? Horrify? Disgust? Perplex her? All of the above. And now Kathleen was tossing around the word sociopath. When exactly did women start using that word in dating situations? Spence wondered. Had Oprah done a show on it or something? Because lately, at least, it seemed like it kept coming up. Amanda and Mark liked to be in bed by 10, so Holly left after the dishes were done. Married people with early bedtimes annoyed her, as did married people who whispered to each other at parties, and married people who went on diets at the same time, and married people who said, "We're pregnant." She could probably come up with a few more if she gave it a little thought. She made a quick call from the cab, and when she pulled up in front of her building 15 minutes later, Lucas was already there, leaning up against one of the doorposts with his hands in his pockets. It was interesting, Holly found herself thinking, that in all the dinnertime talk of her desperation and loneliness and woebegone divorced girl patheticness, she had somehow failed once again to mention him to Amanda. This was, given the parameters of her friendship with Amanda and the intricacies of her relationship with Lucas, a fairly major omission. The parameters of her friendship with Amanda were that they told each other everything. And the intricacies with Lucas were he was 22 years old and she was sleeping with him. Holly had met Lucas 6 weeks earlier at a baby shower hosted by her friend Betsy, salsa dancing Betsy. Betsy, who was notorious for being incapable in this city of 8 million people, of meeting any man not of the hand down the front of the pants variety. Lucas was Betsy's younger brother, and he lived with his parents in the immense Park Avenue apartment Betsy had commandeered for the shower. At the time, of course, Holly didn't realize that Lucas actually lived there, at home, with his parents. She'd figured he'd just stopped by to help out with the coats. The night before the baby shower, Holly had had sex for the third time with Steve, a 43-year-old real estate agent who was on Lexapro for anxiety and who Amanda had taken to calling the Texan because Holly happened to mention that he wore cowboy boots on their first date. Holly resisted calling the Texan because she knew that once a man had a nickname, the relationship was doomed. None of her friends ever ended up with a man they'd given a nickname, with the sole exception of Fleur, who eloped with a guy the rest of them knew only as Coke Can. It was incredibly awkward for all involved. Sadly, the Lexapro meant that the Texan was all hat and no cattle in the bedroom. That's not quite the right metaphor. He had the hat and he had the cattle, but no lasso? Or he had a hat and a bunch of cattle and a lasso and a branding iron and some chaps, but the dinner bell never rang? Whatever, the man couldn't come. Like most men of this sort, he was quite proud of how long he could last. He thought that this was a real selling point, and that any woman would love to engage in multiple lengthy rounds of inconclusive intercourse, which ended with her partner slumped at the foot of the bed with his head in his hands. Holly had broken things off earlier the day of the shower. It's not that she didn't like sex. It's just she liked for there to be an end in sight. Besides, she knew how this particular story played itself out. You wound up with an irritable, frustrated, hostile man who also happened to be an incipient lunatic. The island of Manhattan was full of them. Holly had had to leave the shower early, and Betsy's brother, Betsy's baby brother, showed her to the guest room to get her coat. He helped her into it, and then he put his hands on her shoulders and turned her around and kissed her on the lips. "This sort of thing never happens to me," Holly found herself thinking, mid-kiss. She hadn't spoken two words to this person, and now they were kissing, somewhat furiously, in a bedroom full of baby shower attendees' coats. "Maybe this is the party favor," she thought. "Maybe this is how they do things on Park Avenue." 2 days after the shower, her telephone rang.
"I have to kiss you again," a voice said.
"Who is this?" said Holly.
"Lucas. I'm the one who kissed you at the baby shower on Saturday."
"Betsy's brother."
"Yes," said Lucas. "Can I come over?"
"I don't think so," said Holly.
"I just want to kiss you."
Well, she thought about the Texan and his Lexapro penis. "I guess that would be all right." She gave him her address.
"Great, I'll be right over."
"Lucas?"
"Yeah?"
"I just ran out of toilet paper," said Holly.
"Okay.
Can you pick some up on your way over?" Afterwards, lying in a tangle of sheets, Holly had turned to him and said, "Can I ask you something?"
"Sure."
"How old are you?"
23.
"You're 23?" said Holly. Her eyes wanted to go wide, but she kept them under control. He reached over and grabbed a pillow and scrunched it up behind his head.
"Almost 23.
"Oh my God, you're 22?
"Technically, but my birthday's coming up."
"Why?"
said Lucas. "How old are you?"
"Old," said Holly. "Old enough to be your mother, if we lived in biblical times or, you know, Appalachia."
"You're not old."
"You have to promise me one thing," said Holly. "Promise me you won't tell your sister we slept together."
"I don't tell Betsy about my personal life."
"Good. You know what? Don't tell anybody. Let's just keep this our little secret," said Holly. And now I even sound like a child molester.
"That's straight out of the handbook."
"Page 11, said Holly. "Right after the part where I lure you into the back of my van with a box of kittens." Now it was 6 weeks later, and Holly and Lucas had fallen into something of a routine. On nights when Lucas went out with his friends, he would, more often than not, call Holly at 10 or 11 and once even at 1, and she would usually, but not always, invite him over. Occasionally, twice, actually, not including the night of Amanda and Mark, Holly would call him. It was an arrangement. It was no strings attached. It was what Holly wanted. "Why are we watching this?" said Holly as she made her way back from the kitchen with a glass of ice water. Lucas was in bed, propped up against the headboard with the remote control in his hand, tuned in to the local news.
I want to see the weather, he said.
You can go check it on my computer.
It's coming right up.
That's what they always say, said Holly. She crawled back into bed next to him. They want us to sit here and watch the report on bacteria in hot dog vendor water, so they say it's coming right up. But really, they just move it around to different parts of the broadcast. If I were in charge, some nights I would skip it altogether. Make people crazy.
A woman was raped on her way to work in Jamaica, Queens this morning. At 7 o'clock this morning, Dee Dee Reynolds kissed her three children goodbye and headed off to Mount Sinai Hospital, where she worked as a nurse's aide. Moments after closing her front door, she was brutally attacked.
Who is raping at 7 a.m.? Said Holly.
What do you mean? Said Lucas.
I mean, who's in the mood to rape another person at that time of day? Said Holly. I can barely put my contact lenses in.
Whoever he is, he's got a lot of get up and go, said Lucas.
If only he could channel that into something other than raping people, said Holly.
You're the perfect woman. You know that?
I do, said Holly. And thank you. Lucas muted the TV.
I got a call today from this friend of mine who lives in Austin, he said. He wants me to go out there and help with this club he's starting. Live music, drinks, local bands, but also the South by Southwest stuff. It sounds like it would be fun and a good opportunity. His dad has an inn with someone and thinks we could get a liquor license without too much trouble.
You should do it.
Come with me.
Move to Austin with you? You're kidding, right?
I'm serious, said Lucas. I think I'm falling in love with you.
No, you're not. Trust me. Don't even say things like that.
Why not? It's true. I think you're amazing.
Hold this, Holly said. She handed him her glass of water and then sat up, folding her legs under herself Indian style. Did you know they don't let kids say Indian style anymore? At my nephew's school, they call it crisscross applesauce. The teacher says, everybody get in a circle and sit down, crisscross applesauce. Lucas just looked at her. Oh my God, Holly said. Please don't tell me you grew up saying crisscross applesauce.
I'm not eight.
Right, good. So, she picked up a pillow and clutched it to her stomach. Ordinarily, I am the person who falls in love quickly and somewhat inappropriately and then goes on to destroy what is a good thing. That's always been my style. So, you know, I get it. And I feel right now the way I imagine all those guys felt with me. And I have to say, for the first time in my life, I feel something approaching compassion for them. She took a breath. I just got divorced. You're only 22. I'm not ready for anything serious. And neither are you.
Okay.
We should be sensible and just enjoy this for what it is because it's great, you know? It's fun and casual and we shouldn't start loading it down with expectations and, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, fine.
That's all you have to say?
What else is there to say?
He rolled over and grabbed his Corona from the nightstand. Holly looked at him. He did seem fine.
What? Said Lucas.
I don't know. She got up and headed for the bathroom. Whenever I've been on the other end of this conversation, I've always had a lot more to say. The Mighty Moppets. You look really gay in that shirt.
Thank you, said Leonard.
He smoothed his hand slowly down his chest.
It was very expensive.
Is it my imagination? Holly said. Or are you getting gayer and gayer? It was not Holly's imagination. Leonard had been, for a long time, a very straight-seeming gay man. But over the past several months, due to a confluence of circumstances and fashion choices, he had been appearing progressively gayer. It was probably, primarily, mostly, the chemical hair straightening. Leonard had spent $400 to get his hair straightened with the new Brazilian hair straightening chemical. And now it clung to his head like a wet washcloth and then spiked out at the ends down at the top of his neck, which was huge, due to the steroids he got from a pharmacist who ran an underground steroid ring out of his fourth-floor walk-up on Christopher Street. Leonard had found out about it at his gym. Leonard was Holly's former and only recently again current writing partner. They had worked as a successful sitcom writing team for 5 years, and then they split up so Holly could write her book. They had also slept together years ago, but now they were like brother and sister. They were, truth be told, like a brother and sister who had slept together. Holly felt she had a claim on Leonard that went beyond the mere prerogatives of friendship, and Leonard felt the kind of queasy and confused tenderness that one would imagine a brother might feel after having had sex with his sister, twice, a very long time ago. "Can you focus?" said Holly.
"I feel too good to focus."
"Why don't you take one of your pills?"
"I already took one."
Holly looked at him. He was stretched out on the couch, and yet still somehow managing to rock his body slowly back and forth.
"You swallowed it, or you snorted it?" "I ingested it."
"Through your nose or through your mouth?" "Leonard, it's not even noon."
"I was going to swallow it. I was all prepared to swallow it, but then you went to the bathroom and I accidentally pulverized it with your Palm Beach snow globe and inhaled it, and now I feel so good, which makes it hard for me to consider it a mistake."
"Your doctor belongs in prison."
"Doctors," Leonard corrected her. "My doctors belong in prison."
Holly put her head in her hands. "I don't want to work this weekend, Leonard. We have to pitch on Monday, and we don't have anything, and now you're high as a kite."
"I can still work. Look at me. I'm working. I'm focused."
Leonard sat up and put his hands on his knees like a benched football player who wants to be put back into the game.
"Just tell me what we're doing. What crappy show is this we're writing for again?"
The show was called The Mighty Moppets, and it was an embarrassing piece of crap. It was about a junior high school girls' basketball team, and it aired at 3:30 in the afternoon on Nickelodeon. What was next? Writing for a game show? The show was shot in Toronto to take advantage of Canada's tax breaks, but the writers worked in New York so the network could keep a closer eye on them. The staff was composed of writers who were on their way up, writers who were on their way down, and Canadians. Leonard and Holly were on their way down. "Leonard, you have to care about this script," Holly said. "You have to care about this job. You have to come in here in the morning, on time, sober, with your ADD medication still in tablet form. And you have to forget that you've written for better shows and funnier actors and have been paid a lot more money. You have to put your whole heart into this job, or we're going to get fired." Leonard just sat there. "Do you hear me?" Holly said. "We're going to lose this job, and our career is going to be over, Leonard. This is the bottom rung." Leonard was still silent.
"What?"
Leonard, calmly and with zero affect, said,
"The day that I care about this job, the day I wake up in the morning and realize that I care the tiniest shred about this shitty, stupid tween cable show whose target audience is an 8-year-old girl who wants to buy My Little Pony, is the day I finally kill myself."
"Leonard,
I can't care about this job, Holly. It will damage me."
Holly sighed. "Okay, but you have to act like you care. He thought about it.
I will try to act like a person who is pretending to care.
That was the trouble with the ADD medication. It was getting harder and harder for Leonard to refrain from grinding up the pills and snorting them. The pill, when taken as directed, was effective in keeping him focused on the task at hand. He would take one before he played a video game, and then he could play for hours, hours of complete absorption. The absorption of a carefree 12-year-old boy playing a video game while hopped up on Adderall. It was as close to a pure and clean pleasure as Leonard got. He felt, while doing that, the way he supposed a normal person felt while watching the sunset over the ocean after a 6-mile run. The problem was that the same pill, when pulverized with the back of a spoon, or a paperweight, or a bottle of Grey Goose and then snorted, was better. Different and better. Like watching the sunset over the ocean while high on cocaine. That's where things got tricky. Leonard's various addictions had escalated in the months he'd been in New York. Two things about Los Angeles conspired to engender an ounce of moderation. First of all, it was a company town. Wherever Leonard went, he saw people he knew, agents he'd like to represent him, writers he'd like to work with. And the part of him that was still ambitious and felt what was left of his career slipping through his fingers knew it was best to avoid being flat-out crazy drunk and high all the time. And second, there was the driving. Leonard owned a $1.3 million house on Mulholland Drive, and the bars he liked to frequent were clustered along Santa Monica Boulevard in West Hollywood. And the only way to get from one location to the other was via Laurel Canyon. Two narrow lanes of twists and turns and the occasional treacherous drop through the dry brush and eucalyptus trees into some music producer's black-bottom swimming pool. Oh, Leonard could drive drunk. He had perfected a technique which involved closing his right eye and hunching down in his seat so he could line up the double yellow paint with the left edge of his windshield and the hood ornament of his Mercedes. But the move to New York had meant he didn't have to worry about that anymore. He could drink until he was barely sentient. He could pass out in taxis. He could stumble from curb to front door to elevator, elevator to bed, all in what a reasonable person would consider a state of blackout intoxication. Leonard didn't consider it a blackout because, well, he got from the bar to his bed, did he not? That didn't happen by magic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.